Hey, Caitlin, in a very loud voice, confident, full of enthusiasm, tell us how the DHCP stuff works.
DHCP went on broadcast to the network and asked if they had any IP addresses available, and the network will unicast back to them.
Yeah, don't worry about the order of all that. It will eventually, yes, but keep going.
It'll go back to the DHCP server and it'll say, yes, we have an IP address, and then DHCP will either accept or deny it.
Yep, that's it. So a DHCP, as Caitlin said, a DHCP client, give me an example of a DHCP client. Christopher, your computer, right? Your network computer boots up, and there is a software component in the operating system called the DHCP client that will announce itself and it will broadcast out. Why does it have to broadcast? And this is one of those examples of why broadcast happens. Why does it have to broadcast? Why doesn't it go directly to the DHCP server? Do you know? Good guess, but that's not it. Michael. No, that wouldn't be why it would broadcast. That would be why it would probably unicast. Yes?
Wouldn't it be because of how many DHCP servers there are? Because unicasting would take a long time.
Okay, keep in mind, your computer, kind of. Aaron says, would it be because there are multiple DHCP servers on the network? Ideally, no. There aren't. But there could be. But the important thing is, here's an example. If you lost your phone, and you knew that you lost the phone somewhere in this class, right? How would you get it back? You couldn't see it. What?
Ask people.
Sound off?
Ask people if they found it.
You would ask people if you found it. You wouldn't know directly who to go to find it. So you would just make a general broadcast announcement saying, hey, has anybody found my phone? Right? Okay, now at that point, just like a DHCP server, just like a DHCP client, perhaps Dustin says, well, I found a phone. Can you describe it to me so that I make sure it's yours and not somebody else's? Can you describe it to me? And he would say that maybe in a broadcast too, across the room, right? Either end of the room. At that point, he would describe the phone, and then Dustin would say, okay, it looks like this is the right one. Let's confirm it. And then now it's unicast directly to each other. The reason a client, DHCP client, broadcasts is because they didn't know where the DHCP server is. It's just now coming on the network. If it knew where the DHCP server is, like it will later on when it tries to renew that IP address, if it knew, then it would send the message directly to the DHCP server. Okay? And that switch, how would the switch know that, let's say Aaron's computer is talking to Dustin's computer, which is a DHCP server, in unicast traffic, using a unicast message, and there's a switch in between. How does that switch, which has 48 ports, know that Aaron is talking, wants to talk directly to Dustin's computer? How does it know? Aaron knows this, you better know this. Q, how does it know? It's not going to broadcast. The switch knows that it's going directly to his computer. How? And not by IP address. Think layer two.
Yeah, I know what it is.
Keeping track of what? What is like bottom bullet?
MAC address.
The switch is keeping track of the MAC address. And so that DHCP client talks directly to that DHCP server. The switch is able to make transmit that communication without broadcasting it because it's keeping track of his MAC address on that port where it plugs in, and it's keeping track of his MAC address. And when that packet comes across saying, hey, DHCP server, I want to renew my IP address, it is addressed. The source address is his MAC address. The destination address is his MAC address, and it's able to facilitate the communication. Okay, so just start thinking about how that stuff works. Okay, layer two switches, we talked about this the other day. Security is a concern with layer two switches. Why is that? Tex?
Layer two switches are a security issue.
Because?
Because if they're...
There's a threat of something. Yes, Seth?
Mac flood attack.
A Mac flood attack, just like it says up in the slide. A Mac flood attack is a device on that switch sending out, trying to shut down a port on the switch by sending out massive quantities of data or massive MAC addresses. Austin, you had a question?
I was going to say something along like DDoS, but I don't know if that would...
Like a denial of service attack? Yeah, denial of service. When you say DOS to an old guy like me, I think DOS, disk operating system?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, we talked about virtual LANs. Why would we have virtual LANs? I know we went over this the other day, but clearly we need to go over it again because you guys didn't kind of absorb this information. Why do we care about virtual LANs? What is the purpose of these, Josh? To reduce collisions by doing something. There's a term I use. You guys can just... What do they do to the switch? When I create a virtual LAN, what am I doing to that switch? Yes?
I'm making this group of computers all talk to this group.
Think of it like I'm cutting it up into pieces that usually can't talk to each other, but I can force them to talk to each other. So I'm taking a 24-port switch, and I'm making a 6-port switch, a 2-port switch, 12-port switch, 8, whatever. I'm running out of ports here, but you get the idea, right? So I'm carving it up into these little virtual switches called virtual LANs. Virtual LANs. And let me give you the example. And you'll probably forget this, but I want to give it anyway. When I create a virtualized environment, don't confuse it with virtual LANs. I have a server that's got 12 network interfaces on it, okay? Because of redundancy and the different networks I'm going to be talking to, this one server has 12 network interface cards on it. And then I'll have three of those. I'll have three of those hosts, typically. Of those 12, which are identical in each one of the hosts, I'll carve it up into three separate networks. So four of the adapters are what we call iSCSI traffic on each one of them. Six of the adapters are management, or I'm sorry, six of them are production, and then we keep two for management. The four that are iSCSI, as an example, have an IP address assigned to them of 172.whatever. The next six may have an IP address of 192.whatever, and then the two production or the two management, depending on which ones I do, management production may have 10.something IP addresses. Those, even though those 12 network interface cards are on the same computer, they're not talking to each other. Each one of them, of the three hosts, has those VLANs assigned to it. And so even in those environments, even if they wanted to, they couldn't talk to the other networks. I'll have a 96-port switch broken up into those three VLANs also. Depending on how many ports I need, I'll carve it up with the interface, identifying which ports are which. What I'd like to do very, very quickly, I hope, is show you an example. I'll tell you what, let me set it up so we don't waste a bunch of time. Time is precious. I'll do that later. Okay, packets. What are we looking at here in this slide, these packets? What is this called? The program or the device that's intercepting packets and looking at this. What's it called? There's a name for it. In general, there's a name for it. Anyone know?
I do.
Besides Austin? Austin, what's the name of it?
I've heard people call it Sniffer.
Sniffer. Okay, a packet sniffer. It gets on, it's another network device that's on, or another... network interface connection to the network, and it's intercepting all these packets. Okay, intercepting all these packets, it's looking at them and seeing, hey, what kind of traffic is being transferred between devices. Why would I have a network sniffer on the network? Give me a practical use for a network sniffer. Yes?
To detect bad packets or...
So that I can what?
Detect bad
packets. Great, great point. Not as nearly as prevalent now, as it was 10 years ago, but it still happens. I want to be able to find out if I've got a chatty network card. Aaron? So I can detect who's creating or what port is transferring denial of service attacks, as an example. Yes?
Intercept incoming and outgoing communications without actually being...
Or I could be a friggin' hacker and try to steal data by intercepting inbound and outbound communications. I don't use it for that, but theoretically I could. How would you avoid, if I were a network guy, like I am, and I want to keep people from being able to intercept packets and detect what they are, how would I protect? There are several ways of protecting against that. Give you one. What's that? You're absolutely right. I could institute a VPN if I'm connecting to the internet. What does a VPN do? There's something it does that I want you to... Kinda, but not really. You're on the right track. What does a VPN do to packets that protects against people like Jordan Bowering, who has a network sniffer and this evil package that steals people's credit card number? Come on. Raise your hand if you know the answer. Oh, you started it. You did. Nope. What does it do? It does something to the packets. No, Austin. We got you. I believe that you know this. Maybe you're the guy I should be worried about. No one in the new class knows this. Yes, Caitlin. It encrypts the packet. It encrypts a packet. Honestly, is there anyone who does not know what encryption is? No, because you all watched Mission Impossible movies, right? Encryption. Honestly, does anybody not know what encryption is? So, okay, I'm not going to explain it then. Encryption hides that packet from others. Okay, that's one way of doing it. Another way of protecting against people putting a packet sniffer on your network, okay, and intercepting, let's say inside the network, not the internet, but inside the network, is by maintaining physical security. And this is something that I preach to my clients on a regular basis. If people are in and out of your business all day long, right, and you don't have good physical security, swipe in with a badge, swipe out with a badge, whatever it may be, then my suggestion is if a port, let's pretend that all, and maybe 5 years ago they were, see all these wall plates that are on here on the wall? In fact, some of them, probably, well, here's one. There are four ports here, okay? Four ports here, four network Ethernet ports. RJ45 connections that are connected to wire, that go back to a wiring closet someplace, that are punched down in a patch panel, which is a non-intelligent device. What I tell my clients is if the port is not being used, if you don't need it for a desk, for a desktop computer or something, if it's not being used, then back where it goes to the patch panel, disconnect it from the switch, right? Because if people are coming in and out of your business all day long, they can take a network cable, plug in there, and run a packet sniffer and intercept packets that are going across that switch at least, maybe more, depending on how sophisticated it is. If they have physical access to your network, then they can get the data. That's step one. Step two is, if you want to encrypt that data, which I highly recommend, not only the authentication, but also the data packets, you can do that. And that's one of the many benefits of using Microsoft networking, because it's built into the operating system. All you have to do is turn it on. Okay? So those are two things you can do. Protect, and remember this, write it down, etch it in your hearts forever. Two ways to protect against packet sniffers. First one is secure the basically physical security, restricting people who can get on your network in many different ways. And one example is just disconnect that port, right? Because it takes a lot more guts to walk over to an accountant's desk, unplug the network cable, plug yours in, than it does just to find an empty port and just plug into it and run the evil software that you're running. First one is physical security. What's the second one, Q? Protect against sniffers. But VPN does something that Caitlin said. Encrypt the packets, encrypt everything. Okay, so that only those devices that are authorized can see the data in the packets or see what we call the authentication headers. You'll see that question again, folks. Okay, network layer. This is actually where we left off the other day. Layer 3. A layer 3 switch we decided earlier does what? Diamond Supply Company.
What's up? Layer 3 does what?
That's my question. What does a layer 3 switch do?
It routes.
And routes, switches. That's all I needed. It routes packets. Okay? It routes packets. But there's actually a device that does that also that we're used to. Not a switch, but a what? Yes?
A router.
A router. Okay? Name some router manufacturers. Name one. Yes, Austin. I don't think they manufacture any routers. Miguel. What's that? Netgear. Netgear makes a router. How many have a Netgear router at home? I've got one.
Okay. It says centrally warm,
what?
It says centrally warm.
Yeah, they don't actually manufacture it. They will put their label on it so you can't determine who manufactured it. But if you look underneath, my guess is you'll see something like Adtran, Netgear. There are other manufacturers on the router. CenturyLink doesn't guarantee. Yes, Karen.
Cisco,
another big router manufacturer, the best. Yes.
Linksys.
Say again.
Linksys.
I'm not familiar with that. Probably Linksys, right? Yeah. Now Linksys is now owned by Cisco, by the way. Yes, sir.
Apple makes it too.
I can't hear you.
Apple.
I don't know. Again, I think it may be like CenturyLink, but I don't know that for sure. They may make their own routers, but I don't think so.
Make Air Force.
I think they'll put their name on them. Yes?
Buffalo Technology.
Name it? Like a Buffalo box. I associate them with storage, not routers. But they may make them. Routers, you know, you guys have a router built into your operating system. We're going to find out when we get into the server side of it, is that you could use a Windows server as a router in a pinch without paying another dime. Now, granted, in order to be able to do that, you have to have two separate network interface cards, at least with two separate network IDs, so on and so forth. But your computers, the Windows operating system, all the different versions, function as routers also. In fact, if you go out to a command prompt, everybody go out to a command prompt very quickly to include the remote students. Go out to a command prompt. And if you're having trouble with that, all you need to do, if you've got Windows 8.1, hit the little Windows key, type CMD. Nope, you've got too much stuff in there. You don't have to type it out. You can just do, yep, and hit enter. Okay, everybody got a command prompt? Type the following. Route, spelled R-O-U-T-E, space print. Route, space print. And what you'll see is the routing table for your computer, and then hit enter. Okay, now you'll see IP version 6. You might want to scroll up to see IP version 4, which will make more sense to you. And you can see all the different interfaces that are associated with your computer. Now, one of the things we can do, and I don't want you to do this because I don't want you to do it now, we'll do it later as part of the lab, is you can use a command called route space add space and tell that computer, if you have multiple interfaces on it, how to move packets that are from here and you want to change the destination to go somewhere else. Okay? We use a command called route add, and you can create a persistent route on your computer so that even if Miguel and Zach are on the exact same network, I can make all packets that come from Zach's computer go to this switch or to this router, internet maybe, and all packets that go from Miguel go to a different computer. Can we do that we do that quite a bit. Not a lot, but not always, but quite a bit. Okay? So layer 3 is responsible for routing. Give me an example of a protocol that we use. Remember the 7 layers of the OSI model. It's a model that represents devices and protocols. The device that we talked about is either a layer 3 switch at this layer or a router. That's a physical device. Give me an idea of the protocol that we use at this layer. An example of a protocol. No one? Aaron, Caitlin, or Q, give me an example of a protocol that we use. Just name one protocol. Aaron. Name one protocol. FTP is a protocol. Not at the network 3 layer, but it is a protocol. Give me another protocol. TCP? Yep, absolutely. Q, give me another one. UDP, another protocol. Okay? What protocol? Give me an example of a protocol used at the network or the layer 3 network layer. What's the one you're missing? No, SMTP is email. That's application layer. Presentation layer, maybe. Come on. What kind of address do you have on your computer? Huh? You have a MAC address, yes, that's layer 2. Zach? IP address, that's layer 3. IP address. 192.168.blah, blah, 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 okay? Those are IP addresses. Those are what are used at the network layer, okay? Those are what are used at the network layer. IP addresses. Could be IP6, could be IP version 4, could be a protocol that you're probably not familiar with at all. Can anyone name a protocol that, I mean, IP is used everywhere. But in the old days, we had other protocols. Do your books talk about other protocols? Okay, by the end of this next break, I want you guys to look this up. Other routable protocols. I want you to find out and then report back to me. Other routable protocols, or routable protocols. Okay, so we have the logical addressing of hosts instead of physical addresses, which every one of them is still going to have a physical address. The addressing system of the computer is stored in the operating system, for example, IP addresses. Unit of measurement on this is called packets. So by the time it gets to the network layer, we have gone from frames, which are down here, now we have formed something called packets. And those packets will have a source IP address, Austin, and a destination IP address. Okay, that's what allows it to work. That's what allows it to send it. Do I need the network layer when I'm in a local area network and not going into the internet or to somebody else's network? Do I need the network layer for communications? How many say yes? I need the network layer if I want to communicate with other computers on a local area network. How many say no, I don't need the network layer if I want to communicate with other? The two people that had the three, or whatever, how many that raised their hand and said, no, I do not need the network layer to communicate with other computers, are absolutely right. I do not need the network layer because I can broadcast, right? I can broadcast and not have to work using MAC addresses and be able to communicate with other devices. This is very, very important that you know this. If, however, I want to efficiently, I can still use it in a local area network, but it's not required. If I want to go beyond that one local area network and connect to a wider area network, in other words, across a router, I must use the network layer. It does not have to necessarily be IP. It could be another protocol, which you guys are going to tell me about. It could be another couple different protocols that are routable, but it does not have to be IP. It does have to be a network layer. I use that for addressing. We already talked about layer 3 switches. Similar to routers, but cheaper and not as sophisticated. Now we move up to the transport layer. This is where transport session layer, these are kind of confusing, okay? So you're really gonna have to focus and you're really gonna have to think about how the transport layer works. And when we start talking about that, there really aren't any physical devices that we are focused on at the transport layer. These are all protocols, okay? These are all protocols. So, transport layer. Here's what it does. Just think conceptually Back to this book, right? How do you think this book was created? What program? Name a program that could create this book.
Microsoft.
Frank. Microsoft Word. So someone used Word. What layer of the OSI model is Word? Jessica. Application layer, highest layer, right? Somewhere, someone used Microsoft Word to create this, copied it or saved it into electronic format in a file, right? And that file is 2 megabytes, 2 gigabytes, it doesn't matter. It's a file, 2 gigabytes as an example. Maybe it's a 2 gigabyte file. If I want to transfer this from my Word application to Austin's Word application so he can open it up and edit it, modify it, change it, and we're going across the internet, to do that, I have to break this up into tiny itty-bitty packets. Okay, bunch of little packets, because it's just too big, too complex to take all at once. And so let's say I break this up into 1,000 different packets. And let's say this is a gigabyte file, and to make it easy, each one of the packets is 10 megabytes. Okay? And I don't know what number that works out to, but essentially watts, right? I have to break these up, and each one of those is unique, right? Each one of them, you know, that 10 megabytes could be this copyright warning, or half this page, or a third of this page, or it could just be the formatting, okay? So I break it up into these little bytes, and then I have to send those bytes in packets, right? Send those bytes in packets. Okay, as I break them up and send them out, they are numbered, okay? They're identified uniquely. Something is responsible for breaking them up, sending them out in packets, and then at the other end, the transport layer is responsible for what, Seth?
What?
If I break up those packets, and let's just make it simple, into pages even. Let's say each one of these is a separate packet. It's not. That's ridiculous, but what, for purposes of this argument, let's talk about it. So, if I break this page up into packets and send it out, and it goes across a router, it goes across the internet, it goes the other side of the world to the Chinese, right? The transport layer is responsible for doing what with that?
Sending the message.
No, on the other end, what's it responsible for?
Receiving it.
Not receiving it, because that's being done at the physical layer, the communication sublayer, right? Physical. Data link and the network that's responsible for receiving it, but there's something that takes place within the computer that has to happen to those packets. Yes?
Reassembly.
Now, where did you get that million-dollar word?
Reading
the slide. Yes. Yes. Reassembling those packets in order. Because if this copyright page is put in the wrong order, it's going to end up in the middle of the document, which doesn't do me any good. It has to be reassembled in the exact order that it was split apart. And so the transport layer is responsible for numbering, for keeping track of those packets, and then sending them, you know, separating them up with unique numbers on it, and then at the other end, reassembling them into the right order, okay? So think about that for the transport layer. And if you understand that, then you'll do well, understand how that works, which is really all we've talked about. Then you'll do well and understand how it's used. There are a couple protocols, I think we talk about them. Yes, there are two protocols that are responsible for the transport layer. These are TCP, UDP. Where have we seen TCP before? What have we talked about that includes TCP? Chris? Johnny? What? Where have we seen the initials or letters TCP before? We've talked about them. No one knows this? This is as simple as it gets as far as the question. Where have you heard the term TCP before? Yes?
File transfer systems.
File transfer what? Tell you what, everybody, right-click on, or I'm sorry, hover over your network, your wireless little adapter there, right-click on it, and go to Open Network. right click on Open Network and Sharing Center. Okay, and then click on Change Adapter Settings. And then right click on your Ethernet adapter. And go to Properties. And scroll down. Keep going. There you go. Internet protocol, TCP/IP, 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 over and over and over and over again, TCP/IP. TCP/IP is what we use to communicate on the network. It's everywhere, okay? But it's actually a suite of protocols. What do I mean by that?
It houses most of the protocols.
And say it again?
It houses most of the protocols.
What are most of the protocols?
Houses.
It houses most of the protocols, what he said. It's several protocols are made up within the TCP/IP suite, okay? You may think it's just TCP and then just IP, but actually the implementation of TCP/IP on your computers, when we load that protocol, which is loaded by default, when you build the operating system, it's installed automatically. You could remove it, but then we wouldn't be able to communicate on the network. We could still function as a computer, but we couldn't send packets back and forth. TCP/IP has many, many different protocols in it, two of which are TCP and IP, two separate protocols. Okay, so when we look at the transport layer, we're primarily concerned with two protocols, TCP and UDP. This is absolutely critical that you get this down, get on your little notes, pay attention, read whatever you need to read, but listen to what I'm saying. One of these protocols is connection oriented. One of these is connectionless. Okay? Here's how it works. A connection oriented protocol. Connection oriented protocol. And this is the term that you'll see on the tests. Connection oriented protocol, which in this case is TCP, but there are others that are out there. We're just going to talk about TCP for now. A connection oriented protocol communicates like this. Jill, I'm going to start talking to you. Is that okay?
Okay.
All right. I'm going to send you a message, and I want you to tell me when you receive that message.
Okay.
The message is this. TCP is a cool protocol. Did you get that entire message?
Yes.
Okay. That's a TCP connection-oriented protocol. Every packet that's sent, maybe it might be five packets at once, but every packet gets a confirmation from the other side. Okay? The majority of my lecture here is a connectionless lecture, okay? Because I'm relying on your attentiveness, I'm relying on your nonverbal communications that you're actually getting it. Okay, but a connection-oriented protocol is, as you can see, in this room, it would be impossible. Everything I said, if this was a TCP communication, everything I said, I would have to go to each one of you and have you repeat it back to me, or at least tell me that you received that transmission properly. Okay, now think about this. You've got thousands and thousands and thousands of packets that are being sent just for this stupid little book, right? So TCP communication can be critical if it requires it, so that you know that the other end receives it, but it's not exactly the most efficient. Okay, so when we're trying to get out lots of information that we don't have to have confirmation, instead, your computer will use UDP, User Datagram Protocol. Okay, sometimes it requires TCP, connection-oriented. TCP equals connection-oriented. Sometimes it will use UDP, connectionless. Okay? In other words, we don't need a confirmation. An application that uses TCP as a web browser. Example application that uses UDP as streaming media. And I don't like that example. They're absolutely right, yes, but it leads you down a different path. So in the example they use up here, a web browser, you're sending data, it's coming back, you're getting confirmations that everything is being sent and received. Every packet is in place, every packet is sent and received. Whereas UDP, if I turn on Pandora, right? If I turn on, how many use Pandora in here? Okay, give me another streaming.
Spotify.
Spotify? Okay, you guys have a Julian on. Okay, it's gonna be transmitting whether I tune in or not, right? That's UDP, streaming media. It's gonna be transmitting whether, if there are different ways of watching video. Some of them are streaming media, some of them are not. You have that choice when you upload a YouTube video. Do you want this in streaming media format or not? If it's streaming media format, it's gonna be using UDP as the protocol when other users watch it. If it's not, it's gonna use TCP. Now, why would it be a good idea on YouTube to use UDP instead of TCP? And I'm not saying it's an option, that particular protocol on YouTube, but as an example. Yes? Because what?
So many users that are...
So many millions and millions of users, right? In these lectures, we can have as many as one or two users actually watching the lecture. In fact, that's the case. The last chapter, we only had one or two. On the last video, the last day, we had one or two users watch this. I can see, you know, how many views it's had. And the lectures on that last day, one or two. Well, that's why, by and large, and this isn't a secret, the in-class students had much higher grades than the remote students. Because the remote students merely read, many of them, merely read the book instead of listening to the lecture, which is incredibly boring, I assume, okay? But there's material in the lecture that isn't in the book, right? So there are millions of people looking at videos, and so TCP is tough. That's a lot of transmission going back and forth. UDP, on the other hand, it sends it out. Maybe you don't get all of it, and that's okay, you're gonna get most of it. Austin, you had a question.
Oh, it was more of a comment. I did do a project once about YouTube. And it said in 2006 it used more bandwidth than the entirety of the entire internet in 2002.
Say that one more time. 2006, what?
According to Wikipedia, YouTube used more bandwidth than the entirety of the internet in 2002.
Yeah, so his comment was...
Well, no, they have people moderate it now, so now it's a more reliable source.
Yeah. And I agree, Wikipedia is handy if you don't have to have guaranteed. Wikipedia is great when you're using, I think, this is kind of off topic, this is the BS Eliminator, and it's used regularly at any family gathering that I attend, because my family and my wife's family are so full of inane, ridiculous facts, right? They'll throw something out there, usually politically oriented, and I'll look it up. If I don't know it immediately, I'll look it up and say, you know what? Sorry. You know, that's wrong. Yes, sir.
Now, my mother is like one of those, you know, Facebook moms that, like, you know, posts all this.
Yeah,
like,
I know.
Yeah. Okay, so all the crazy stuff about, it's the blood moon on this.
We've seen this stuff, yeah. Crazy stuff.
So I'm like, I sit down with her, okay, I pull up Snoops.
Yeah, actually, Snopes. And Snopes is questionable also. Snopes has come out recently. There have been things about Snopes. Yeah, I used to use Snopes all the time to verify facts.
Yeah.
Yeah, but be careful with
it. Or I'll just Google it, and we'll be like...
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot. And Wikipedia is good for that kind of stuff. But Wikipedia is not. Does anyone in here have a class, that like an English class, a research paper, anything like that, where a teacher will allow you to use Wikipedia as a source? What's that?
My teacher gave music paper, so they'll check it out before he gets out there.
Yeah. Many cases, Wikipedia is very, very accurate, but you just have to be careful. So, totally off topic. And I remember how we got on that to begin with. Streaming media, YouTube. Oh, I know what it was. Austin said that YouTube in 2006 was using a total bandwidth, and that is relevant to what we're talking about. Just YouTube videos uses more bandwidth than all of the internet. How many years before that?
2002.
Than all of the internet in 2002. So, good reason to use UDP instead of TCP, because TCP, and it's not a choice that you make as a user in many cases. depending on what application you're using, maybe. But instead, the computer will determine that, the application will determine that, higher levels will determine whether it's going to use TCP or UDP. You make that choice as an IT professional in how you design your network, and we'll get into those details and how those choices are made later. Okay, we've talked about connection-oriented, connectionless, inbound, outbound ports for the, here's another very important. So, transport layer, remember connection-oriented versus connectionless, and the two protocols that we're concerned about are TCP and UDP. In addition, transmission or a transport layer is responsible for identifying ports. Here's an example. You're going to be required to memorize certain ports that are used by certain applications. Caitlin, what port is used by HTTP? Hugh, you know? What port is used by HTTP primarily? Aaron? No one knows. Huh? Very good. The default port for HTTP traffic. What's HTTP? Yes, Austin.
It's something like hypertext, something or another. It's basically the...
Hypertext, get it right. Transfer protocol. HTTP is used for what, primarily? You. What's that?
Web browsing stuff.
Web browsing. Websites, okay? HTTP is used primarily for web browsing, okay? So, it uses port 80 by default, okay? So whether you know it or not, in the background, if you type www.google.com, your computer is saying, go out to Google and open up port 80. Or, I'm sorry, I'm going to open up port 80 on my computer, and I'm going to allow traffic from Google to communicate back to me. If you have a website that uses an alternative port, which I have, firewall access, typically if I'm going to use web access to a firewall, I will tell the firewall, I only want you to answer on port 8081 or 8082 or 8083, a user-defined port. And so now if I want to open up, if I want to manage a firewall someplace else that has a web interface to it, on my browser, I have to type let's say I'm managing Google's firewall, assuming that I created it. I'll type www.google.com, what, if it's being managed on port 8081. What will I do, Caitlin? If I want to access a website using an alternative port, and in this case, Google's firewall is being managed by port 8081, how would I force that? How would I type that? Keep going. Q, do you know? Aaron, do you know? If I've set that firewall up to use port 8081 and not answer to port 80, which is the default, then I would type www.google.com:8081 or 8082, whatever I've used. That's how you access an alternate firewall. One, it has to be listening on that port and not listening on the default port of 80. And two, you have to tell your browser, or the application layer, what port to open. And that's all managed at the transport layer. There are a series of ports that are by default. Email uses by default port what? Anyone know? No one knows. Aaron, 25, very good. You remember, I memorized this from last year. Email uses port 25, or SMTP uses port 25. HTTP uses port what?
50.
No, I just check your notes. Maybe you didn't 80. Type it in. Huh?
80.
HTTP uses port 80. Okay. What are some others? FTP uses port 21, 22. So those are default ports. You'll have to memorize some of those. Okay. But think transport layer when you talk about ports. Connection-oriented communication. Someone describe this to me again. How does this work? What is this all about? Yes. Don't worry about reading it.
It sends out a packet and asks for a response, and then it gets a response.
It basically requires confirmation on every packet. Okay, again, you can send five packets at once and wait for a response that all five packets were received, but it still requires confirmation that those packets were received after, or every one of those packets has to get confirmation. UDP or connectionless connections, we do not have to do this. Okay, so the way it manages that is if I send out, so here's the deal. If I ask Jessica, just like I did with Jill, okay, Jessica, I'm getting ready to talk to you. Don't say anything. I'm getting ready to talk to you. Are you ready to receive the message? Don't say anything. Jessica, I'm getting ready to talk to you. Are you ready to receive the message? Jessica, I'm ready to talk to you. Are you ready to receive the message? It's going to resend that message, right? It's going to resend that packet until it gets a response. At some point, it's going to stop doing it and say, we cannot establish a connection with this destination address. Or you're going to get a message that says, you know, basically only half the packets got there, this is not reliable, or the application will get that. When you're on the internet and you connect to a website and your internet connection is down, right, and you get web page not found, there's an example. God bless you. There's an example. Okay, so the thing to remember is connection oriented requires that confirmation. If it doesn't get the confirmation, whether it's one packet or whether it's 30 packets or the entire message, it will resend that message again. Connectionless communication.